in principle, but the church has to take the job to the next level and take the step of taking the gospel of the kingdom to every nation of the earth. That's why we're in Enugu now. Because it's not just you as an individual that God wants to heal, to save, or to deliver. God wants to turn around the quality of life in this state. God wants to change Enugu State so much that everybody will want to come and have a house here, because this place, the life, the quality of life here reflects the quality of life in heaven. This is how you know when heaven has come to earth. I'm sure you know our Lord's Prayer: Our Father which art in heaven, thy kingdom what? Come. Thy will be done where? On earth. As it is what? Done in heaven. You know, when in Enugu you can park your car without locking it, and you go in and come out, you know nothing will go wrong. The kingdom of God has come here. When people love each other like they do in heaven, when we value human life to the point that we can lay down our own life to redeem other people's life, when we start thinking like Jesus, then the kingdom of God has come here. When God's values, when his ways of thinking, when his lifestyle, for example, why are we here? If God is a liar, we won't be here, because we can't trust him. I will not be preaching for him. If he's not a man that has integrity, I will not be here to represent him. The reason I trust him is because he is trustworthy. The reason I represent him is because he is faithful. God not only keeps covenant to those who trust him, he keeps it to their children's children, to 1,000 generations. Do you know what it means? When God commits himself to you, he commits himself to your children, to their children's children, to their children's children's children. Just because he has a relationship with you, he looks after your children after you. Are you hearing what I'm saying? That's the kind of person I want to have as my friend. That is the kind of life they live in heaven. Heaven is a world that is filled with love. It's a place where there is peace. It's a place where there is security. You don't have armed robbery there. You don't have prostitutes there. You don't have immorality there. Nobody wants to steal another person's wife. They don't even marry. But let's assume you are allowed to have. Nobody wants to take what belongs to another. It's a world where everybody wants to give. Everybody's willing to serve. Everybody's willing to sacrifice. We need to build a society that reflects God's plan for this earth. But you see, where the church is coming from, we have preached the gospel of salvation, the gospel of grace that saves men, and have ignored the gospel that changes society, the gospel of the kingdom. But my fear now is, as we are heading to embrace the kingdom, that we don't forget the gospel that saves. That's my fear. As we learn to understand the things of God, how to reshape society and build a new world. You know, in the millennium, when Jesus will be here, when the kingdom will be literally here, there will be unbelievers under his government. The scripture teaches that after he has ruled for 1,000 years, Satan will be given a chance to give men option between Christ and the other kingdom, which is the kingdom of darkness. And millions of people will follow Satan. That means even when we have literally brought the kingdom here, those who are not saved are not saved. I want to say that again. The Bible said there is a battle called the battle of Gog and Magog. Satan will go forth and gather the whole nations of the earth to go and bomb the holy city, the new Jerusalem that will be rebuilt, where Christ is going to rule. Why? Because when a man's heart has not been regenerated, has not been reborn, even if he lives in a society that is like heaven, he's still Satan's child. That is why immediately after that last rebellion, God is going to clean the earth of every last drop of rebellion, because he's not going to allow them to enter the new heaven and the new earth. There is a new heaven coming. There is a new earth coming. And that new heaven and the new earth has another hell created for it, because there will always be prison for criminals, for disobedient people, for rebellion, for rebellious people. There is a new hell created for that one called the lake of fire, Gehenna. But in this present heaven and this present earth, there is a hell created right now that is already in oppression. It was created the moment Lucifer rebelled in heaven, and that hell is right inside the earth. Jesus explained the book of Psalms chapter 16, talking about the death of Christ. He said, "Thou will not leave my soul in hell, neither will thou suffer thy righteous one to see corruption." So we know when Jesus died, he descended. Into hell. We say it in Apostles' Creed. Of course, there is argument, because hell, the underworld, is divided into two major compartments, where you have the Old Testament saints and where you have those that are in torment. Whether he went to the torment side or he went to Abraham's bosom. But the point is that he descended into that place. The Hebrew people call it Sheol. The Greek call it Hades. It has two major compartments. One has, is a lake of fire. It's a place of torment. That's where the rich man cried out from and looked across the gulf and saw Lazarus on the other side. Lazarus was not in heaven. Nobody went to heaven except a few transfigured men until Christ came. Lazarus was in Abraham's bosom. So Jesus was talking about where he was going after his death on the cross. Following his death on the cross, he said, as Jonah was 3 days and nights in the belly of the well of the fish, so will the Son of Man be 3 days and night in the belly of the earth. Do you know that this earth you march on, that is shaped like a football, has a stomach? That stomach. I did this experiment some time ago. I asked everybody who was in the service, I said, put your ear on your neighbor's stomach. I will not ask you to do it, because your neighbor might be a lady sitting beside you, a man. It might not be necessary, but that day I asked them to do it. When you turn your ear and put it on your neighbor's stomach, you will hear boiling. If you can bend your head to listen to your own stomach, you will hear it. It's not only when you have running stomach. Running stomach is when the thing busts open. That boiling thing comes out. As you are listening to me now, your stomach is making no. This earth, we are all sitting here now. Inside this earth, there is something else boiling. It's a boiling inferno. It's a furnace filled with sulfur and brimstone, filled with liquid. It's a liquid rock. That's where every man that dies is, a prison yard created originally for Satan and all the angels that rebel with him. But now everyone that dies in rebellion, that dies in his sin, that's where they descend. You know what is so sad when I think about this issue? After spending maybe hundreds of years or thousands of years or millions of years there, the day they destroy this earth to bet the new earth, they also evacuate all the people inside this present prison called hell to the new prison that will be created for that new heaven and new earth. Somebody said to me once, why would God do such a thing? I said, society will not be sane if society doesn't have prison. Those who don't want to live civilized life have to be removed and kept somewhere so that other people can live a normal life. If you don't want to receive Jesus Christ, you are making a decision that will affect you for eternity. Ministers don't talk about these things anymore. Let me ask you, if a house is on fire and there are people inside sleeping, and you are aware it's happening in the middle of the night, but the people inside the house are asleep, But you are the one that is awake and you are aware. What will you do? What will you do? Eh? Will you want to go to get your bag first, or your furniture, or your car, or will you want to help those lives escape? There are four things everybody here does not know. Everybody. Including those of us who are preaching. The first one is when you will die. A couple of weeks ago, our legislators gathered for their normal government business. While in that house, one of them slept and died. The Bible said he's appointed unto man, wants to die, and after that, judgment. But the issue is, I wish everybody is told you have 5 more years, and it's going to occur on May 29th of that day. What God does for those who work very closely with him is that he prepares them. But I have not even seen any of them that he told the exact day. Read the Bible very well. Somebody like Hezekiah, he sent a prophet to tell him, put your house in order because the time is around. The second thing you don't know is the very day Jesus is returning back. As a matter of fact, when Jesus was in the flesh, he said that the Father kept that secret away from him. The reason is because if he had known, he would have told Peter, James, and John. It will be in the year 2007, December 25th. He said that was kept from the angels. It's kept even from men of God. He said, but God will alert us as the signs, as the time approach. He will make sure that the signs are obvious for us to see. And anybody who has any atom of sense, we know that the signs that the scriptures announce are more obvious today than ever. One of the things I tell God's people, stay away from any preacher who plays with the second coming of Christ. Stay away from him. The Bible said in the last days there will be mockers saying, where is the promise of his coming? There are preachers. I've had a number of, they say, forget, he cannot come this time. There's still so much to do. He cannot come. My friend, wake up from sleep. I looked at the signs of the return of Christ. They have so happened that we are the doorpost. And then Christians are living now that Christ is returning and living as if we are the first century Christians, the ones who started their journey during the day of Pentecost. Paul the apostle and the believers of that time so believed in the return of Christ that it was a propelling force for their missionary life. It was a driving force for evangelism. It was a driving force for the kind of holy life that they lived. We who are living at the close of the age, many of us are living as if we still have 3,000 years. I like how Rehabonke says it. He said the time given is up. We are just living in the extra time. What is most amazing, apart from going to hell for those who are not saved, is very serious. Like you heard, Jesus took hell seriously. Jesus took hell so seriously that he said, it's better to remove your eyes, cut off your own hand, than let yourself go to hell. Jesus preached more about hell than any other subject in the Bible. We who are preachers should follow that example. He knew the consequence of one soul being lost. He said the Son of Man came to seek and to save that which was lost. That he would do everything to warn everybody. There are those of us who are saved and who are sure that we are living for Christ. There is another challenge. The question is, when Jesus returns, what kind of entrance will you have into heaven? When Jesus returns and the people who have lived for him are taken with him into the heavenlies, then the Bible says we must all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. So that every one of us may give account of what we did while we are still in this body, the kind of life that we lived. It will be a time of rebuke, the scripture said, for some. It will also be a time of awards, a time of honor, a time of recognition, a time where many others will be crowned. I looked at the rewards that God will be giving out that day. Some of them are represented in form of crowns. I looked at the conditions attached to them. And I made up my mind that I will not stand before the judgment seat of Christ empty-handed. How you are living your life here is determined by your own perception about these truths. The Bible calls it the crown of glory. I just don't have words to describe it to you. The radiance of that crown. I can't even tell what particular element that was used to make it. Whether it is a shining gold or what. And I said, Lord, why are you showing me this? He said, because this one is going to be given to faithful shepherds, pastors, leaders of God's people, people who are leading cell groups, people who are leading God's people, other younger believers, who fed them, who looked after them, and made sure that they made it. He said, this reward is for faithful ministers. I said, Lord, what are the conditions? He said, the reason I'm showing you is so that you don't get distracted. Many ministers are being distracted. Don't allow what is distracting your colleagues distract you. I said, Lord, what is the condition? He said, number one, the first requirement is that you don't do ministry for money. You don't do it for what you will gain. You don't do it for the profit. The book of 1 Peter chapter 5 said that elders, people that have put over people, pastors, leaders. He said, we are to do this work, not for future lucre. So that when the good shepherd shall come. He said, people will honor you for being a minister of the gospel. That's how it should be. You can teach people their responsibilities. But let your motive for ministry not be for gain or what you will get out of it. And then the Lord gave me an explanation. He said, the motive of a pastor for doing ministry should be the same motive a true mother has for raising the children. You don't raise your children for sale. They are not fowls. They are not goats. You don't raise them for money. You raise them because you love them. Jesus said to Peter, lovest thou me more than this? He said, I love you. He said, look after my sheep. The heart you have for the master is what you shift to human beings that are made in his image that he died for. I said, Lord, is that all? He said, no. He said, the style of leadership will disqualify many pastors from getting it. I said, what do you mean, sir? He said, if you check, because after I went back to read that book of 1 Peter chapter 5, he said, don't be lord over God's heritage. Ministry is not lordship. It is stewardship. It depends on what you're aiming for. He said, don't be lord over God's heritage. He said, the style of leadership is servant leadership. Your motive is to help people, is to build people, is to make people, is to take them from nothing to somewhere. He said the style is that you be an example for the flock. First, seek to be what you are preaching, so that you will make it easier for them to become it. I said, Lord, to get the crown, I'll pay the price. Then he said, that's not all. You might be here and God is calling you into the ministry. Don't let the confusion of this present age deceive you. The Bible said, everyone that striveth for mastery is temperate in all things. They do it to get a crown. Not even a crown. These are awards they give after sports, a trophy. They do it for that perishable thing that doesn't last. We will do it to get an incorruptible crown. The one about enter ministry today because you saw somebody who has a Jeep. Probably God, he don't know the prices he has paid. He don't know the years, what he has gone through. And God is beginning to honor him. And God puts a little thing in your hand today. You want to have everything tomorrow. Then you slaughter the sheep, slaughter your conscience, sacrifice everything. Sacrifice human life. That is the greatest problem in Africa. We don't have value for life. You want to be like in the house overnight. Then the Bible said, the elders that are feed the flock of God, feed, feed. The Lord said to me, your integrity in administering my word will be checked out as one of the conditions for crowning as a minister. Your integrity in administering God's word. He said, don't change the message to suit the times. Don't change it to suit the market. In the last days, many will develop itching ears, but don't change the message to suit their ears that are itching. They want motivational talk. There is a place for that. What is at stake here is the destiny, eternal destinies of men and women. And after the Lord showed me that, I repented so much and cried out my heart and adjusted my heart. And I knew that day that it's not something I'm supposed to do once. That as I run this race as a minister of the gospel, I have to keep checking myself with the standard because it's so easy to deviate. It's so easy. Then I asked the Lord, what about those who are not pastors, who may not be called into full-time ministry? He said, there is a crown for them. There's a crown for Christian service. There's a crown for running the race faithfully, for finishing your course. Paul said, I've fought a good fight of faith. I've finished my course. I've kept the faith. There is laid for me a crown of righteousness. I said, which type of crown is this? He said, this crown is for those who ran the race faithfully, who kept the faith. Your commitment to Christ is not something you do in a crusade. When you leave crusade, you go back to where you came from. My friend, listen, my friend, listen, my friend. Some of you have answered altar calls before. After giving Jesus your life, you collect it back. For those who kept their marriage vow, it's one thing to go to the altar and say, I do, I will love you, I will do it. It's another thing to live the married life. I have fought a good fight. There will be challenges on the way. I have kept the faith. I kept my promise to Jesus that I will live for him for the rest of my life. I kept it to the end. I ran the race. Whether there is persecution, anybody might discard me, my friends might turn away from me, I kept the faith. I have finished my course. I serve God with my life. Then is laid for me a crown of righteousness, which God the righteous judge shall give to me, not only to me, but to everyone that loves his appearing. The people that run the race faithfully to the end are those ones that look forward to his return.
When you lose sight of the return of Christ, the second coming of Christ, that's when all kinds of crazy things start entering into your life. The Bible said those that have this hope in him purify themselves even as he is pure. You know, one thing about the life of Moses that has changed my life so much is written in Hebrews chapter 11 verse 24. He said, when Moses came of age, he refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He was heir to the throne of Egypt, but he rejected it, choosing rather to suffer afflictions with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. And I said, why, Lord? How was Moses able to turn away from all the glory and the wealth of Egypt? You don't know what Moses said no to. Today we teach faith to receive, faith to claim a car, faith to get a wife. Faith, there is faith to reject things. There is faith to lose things. Daniel chose in his heart that he will not defy himself with the king's meat. These are the things that you have come to church to give testimony for. You don't know the president invited me in special food. You won't tell us that the food came from Ogbueli shrine. Those meats were meat dedicated to idols. Moses turned his back on the whole of the glory, the wealth, and the throne of Egypt. Let me tell you what Moses rejected. If you announce tomorrow morning that the American president is offering every Nigerian citizenship. Just 100,000 Nigerians citizenship. That the first to get to International Airport Lagos, if that announcement has gone out by 4 p.m. today, many of you will not be here, because you will be in the bus this night heading to Lagos. But what I said was citizenship. Let's remove citizenship. He just offered green card. And they said Enugu Stadium is where they are issuing the thing. The first 100,000 to reach here. People in Sokoto might get here before you arrive. Those in Bayelsa will reach here before you. You will not be able to cross that gate. But this time around, it was not citizenship that Moses rejected. Moses rejected his right to the throne. He was like the heir to the throne of England, Prince Charles, turning away from all of his future just to come down to Africa and look for one remote part of Africa where people are suffering, to go and identify with them and live and die with them, to lead a group of slaves. And they say, Moses, why did you do it? He said, because I have respect to the recompense of reward. I have seen what God would do for me if I can lay my life, if I can pay this price, if I can be the one that will help further the purpose of God on earth. It's true that God wants to use me, but it will require another level of high level dedication and consecration from my own side. If I don't yield, the program will not work. God will have to find another person. There are many of you that God has called, has impressed in your heart to do one thing or the other. You have been playing with it. You are playing with your eternal destiny. The moment the trumpet sound, there is nothing you can change again. Paul was writing, he said, what will be my crown on that day? What will be my crown of rejoicing? He calls it crown of rejoicing. He said, are ye not my joy? Those of you that have won to Christ, on that day you will be my crown. Because you will be the reason that the Lord will crown me. John, writing about it, said, look after yourself. He was writing to his spiritual children that we lose not what we have labored for. Because God will not reward you for a soul that did not make it. He said, I have chosen you that you might bear fruit and that your fruit might remain. There's a song we used to sing. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus.
No turning back. No turning back.
Come on, musicians, come on, help me and sing it. How many of you know it? It's simple.
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back. If no one joins me, still I will follow. If no one joins me, still I will follow. If no one joins me, still I will follow. No turning back. No turning back. I have decided, sing it, to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus.
Joins me one more time. Still, I will follow.
If no one joins me, still I will follow.
If no one joins me, still I will follow. No turning back. No turning back. No turning back.
Lift your hands and say, no turning back,
no turning back, no turning back,
no turning back.
I give you praise, I give you praise,
no turning back,
I give you praise, Lord,
no turning back.
I have decided to follow Jesus.
A crown that is given to those who have endured persecution for the sake of Christ is the highest honor that is available in heaven. It's for those who have laid their life, who has already given it up. I did not know that I would come out of UNN alive, because when I got there, God challenged me to do something about campus cultism. I stepped on the lions. I entered the lion's mouth. I didn't know that I would come out of that school alive. There is a crown for those who have gone through persecution. Jesus said, when you are going through persecution, when men revere you, when men persecute you for my sake, for the gospel, rejoice. For great is your reward in heaven. That's why we don't have Christians with backbones anymore. Because these teachings are gone. These teachings are no more. We don't have backbones anymore. If there is any challenge, that's why we can't have people who can come out to lay down their life for Nigeria to be changed. Because there is a price. The price for national transformation is death. That's what happened to Mandela. He gave his life in exchange for South Africa. To see leaders who can change society, they will have to die to self. To be able to get into government house and see money that can be used to build hospitals, to better the life of society, and you will not take it. It will take death to self. That's why the church is no more producing sacrificial leaders, servant leaders. We produce them as governor, they lose, they stay dry, because some of these teachings are gone. There is overemphasis on the material side. It's true, God wants to bless us. Nobody creates a product and wants the product to fail. The company that made Roland or Yamaha keyboard, they don't want it to fail. They want their product because their product carries their integrity. God wants you to be blessed. God wants to bless you. God wants to help you financially. He wants to help you, your family. But that is just the lower, the smaller part of the deal. the higher riches of God. John Wesley at the end of his life said, the best of all is God with us. To carry God's presence in your life. To be a friend of God. To be so close to him. To be a man after God's heart. There is no treasure in this earth like it. Amazingly, these ones that cry after him, who want to be like him, who want him to be a reflection of his image, they are the ones he showers his riches on. He said, because if you delight yourself in the Lord, he will give you the desires of your heart. Brothers and sisters, God wants me to talk to you about idols. There is nothing God detests like idols. Whenever the means becomes the end, that means has become an idol. Whenever a process is replacing the product, that process has become an idol. Anything at all that challenges the place of God in your life, anything at all that you value or esteem or respect of or hold in high esteem more than God, is an idol in your life. God hates idols. God hates idols. Whenever the resource starts disconnecting you from your source, that resource has become an idol. It can be money. Some of you pray so hard for a husband. God bless you with a husband. That's why your Christian life has gone down. Because marriage is first in your life. A spouse is more important to you than God. Some of you were on fire for God. And you were believing God for a job. Now he has given you the job. That's why you are lukewarm Christian now. That's why you are useless in the kingdom. Some of you served God so well while you were in school. God has answered your prayer. You have graduated. Things are happening now. Read your thermometer and see. It's almost 0 degrees. Jesus said, if you are lukewarm, I will spew you out of my mouth. You are either hot or cold. Choose one. There is no middle ground in this thing. You are either on fire for God or sell out to Satan. For some of us, it's the car, the positions that God has given us. For some of us, it's the money. The means has replaced the end. The resource has disconnected us from our source. God warned the children of Israel. He said, you will get to the promised land. I will bless you. I will give you a land flowing with milk and honey. But when you get there, beware. After you have built goodly houses, after you are riding a good car, you get a good job, you now have a wife, you now have a husband, beware that you forget not the Lord your God. You are the one that used to give for the advancement of the kingdom of God. You used to sacrifice. Now you have created new philosophies. How can somebody just give to church? The gospel is free, but the means of spreading it is very costly. It cost the man we are following his life. It cost all the apostles that followed him their lives. All of them sealed their testimonies with their lives. If you're going to serve God, it's going to cost you something. Before I make the altar call tonight, I want you to know that. So you don't come here to deceive. It's going to cost you something. It's going to cost you something, but you are going to gain God's all. You are going to exchange your all for his all. He gave you his life and is willing to give you his best. But you are going to give him your life. And it's not just coming. Jesus coming to my ears. I'm going to live the rest of my life serving you. I'm going to live the rest of my life walking with you. I'm going to live my life in such a way that you can use me to touch the lives of others. A group of professors, doctors and professors came from UNN to see me in Lagos. They were Christians. And one of them was telling me, he said, I want to start a ministry. The Lord is calling me. I said, which course do you teach in UNN? He said, yes. I said, in the theater where you teach GS, over 2,000 students gather every morning to hear you. I had a lecturer who was a Marxist teaching me GS in his time. He would take the first 10 minutes to destroy Christianity, to preach the gospel of Marxism and socialism. Then he would teach his course. Then he would take the last 5 minutes to preach again. He destroyed the Bible. He destroyed America. He destroyed churches with his mouth. And when he's talking, you know that he was anointed. The man was anointed. I said, you want to go and open one mushroom thing somewhere, but God has given you 2,000 people in your crusade every day. They pay to come and hear you. This one now, you are going to pay to do the poster, but you are blind. You don't even know why God placed you there. I turned to the other one who teaches a science course. I said, the science lecture theater of that school, how many students gather there every day? How many lecturers are in that school? Over 30,000 students are within that community. Hundreds of lecturers are within that place. God has brought them together for you. You just can't even see it. I'm not saying that God cannot call a one who is within the university community to come out and maybe pioneer a church. But the truth is, what have you done where you are? He says, starting in your Jerusalem, to Judea, to Samaria, to the utmost part of the earth. What have you done where you are? What is your soul winning goal for 2008? What was your soul winning goal for this year? You sat down and played away the whole year. The children of darkness, homosexuals are no more hiding. They have come in the open. The children of darkness are getting bolder and bolder in these last days. The children of light are the ones hiding their light under the bushel. The kind of messages we are hearing are partly responsible for this mess. Some core truth, foundational truths are missing in the church today. The third thing you don't know, and that's where I will stop, is that you don't know the day the Holy Spirit will stop pulling you. The Bible said, my spirit will not wrestle with man forever for his flesh. There is a period when the Holy Spirit will pull on you, will nudge you, give your life to God. He will follow you. He will keep talking to you. He will arrange tracks. He will arrange preachers. Sometimes he will turn on TV. He will have somebody there. He will arrange people who know you. He will do everything. But a day comes, according to the Bible, when he gives up on you and he turns back. And even at that moment, your conscience becomes hardened. The Bible says God gives you over to a reprobate mind. He allows you to have your way. And you will live in your delusion without stop till you hit hell. You don't know the day. When the children of Israel were in the wilderness, they kept rebelling. God kept forgiving. Moses kept praying. God kept forgiving. They did it the first time. They did it the second time. They did it the third time. One day God said, this 10 times I've counted. This generation, they have tested me and proved me and saw my work. I've shown them miracles. I divided the Red Sea for them. I've done all sorts of things. But they tested me these 10 times. I have sworn in my wrath they will not enter into my rest. That day the door closed and these 3 million people perished in the wilderness. Everyone, wherever you may be, stand up on your feet. If hell is not real and I don't know it, I'll prefer to be preaching another thing now. To focus.
shall come to pass. He said, when destruction hit the city, it can kill everybody except the one under the covenant.
The ministry and message of Pastor David Ogbueli has produced profound and outstanding results in the lives of so many. As you continue to watch this broadcast and apply time-tested principles from the teachings of Pastor David, you will watch your life and destiny move from glory to glory.
There's so much God has in store for us. Many are doing without it. Believers are dying poor. Believers are dying without many enjoying the provisions that Jesus Christ died on the cross to purchase for us.
Our vision is to equip you with incredible truths about your inheritance in Christ and turn you into God's tool for transforming your world. Watch Pastor David and expand your world.
Give him praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The Lord started doing operation while we are worshiping. There are two cases. One person is outside. You had an operation before and it was complicated, and now there is need for a second operation because of that problem. God said there is no more need for it. He has perfected that in your body right now. There is a person that is already booked for an operation that's supposed to open up your stomach to adjust and remove certain things. I saw the angels doing that right now. Thank you, Jesus. There's another eye operation that is taking place. Is this growth in the eye that is blocking your ability to see? You don't need the doctor's blade. The Jehovah Jireh has cut it out. Open up, lift up your eyes and see. You will see that that veil covering you has lifted. Thank you, Jesus. Everyone, just lift up your hands. My God, I give you praise. There is a kneecap injury that was just fixed right now. Just right now, it was so damaging. God had just created a new kneecap right there. You can kneel down, you can bend it, you will see that all the things are adjusted. I give you praise, Lord my God. We give you praise. Take everybody right now, these temples, these bodies, we present it to you as a living sacrifice. Cleanse it and fill it with your glory. Fix everything that is wrong with any one of us, everyone here, spirit, soul, and body, by your glorious presence. If you can't swallow, just swallow about 3 times. There is a dissolving of goiter, there is a dissolving of growth within the throat region. Kamandubo Sandaba, I saw an angel pulling out things from somebody's throat. Thank you, Jesus. Glory be to the name of the Lord. This whole place is covered by angelic spirit and the presence of the Holy Spirit. Lift up your hands. There's a mantle. It's looking like white snow covering this whole arena. Wonderful Holy Spirit, take a hold of everyone here tonight, those inside, those outside this civic center. Take a hold of everyone. By your supernatural power, grab their attention and distill divine truth into their hearts. I ask for miracle of transformation, not just in the physical realm as sicknesses and disease leave, but at the soul level, as the faith, the confidence, the assurance of God's people is quickened again. And then in their spirit man, awaken that giant that you created when you made us new man in Christ. The and your people will rise up to become masters of creation, masters of circumstances, masters of demonic powers, instead of being the ones that are attacked on a daily basis, that they will rise up and oppress the oppressors. They will rise up to take advantage of all the privileges that you've given to them in Christ. Thank you for opening a mighty door of access tonight for everyone to enter into the holiest of all. We thank you. We give you praise. We glorify your name in every life. In Jesus' name. Amen. Let me look at one or two, three scriptures with you. First, Psalm 103, I'm sure you know that already. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Verse 2. Forget not all his benefits. And he started listing them, and the first one he listed is found in verse 3. Who forgiveth all thy iniquities,